grace and you've had mercy, dear Heavenly Father, upon us, dear God, and you have watched over us and kept us daily. Dear Heavenly Father, we pray for those who have stood, dear Heavenly Father, and who may not have stood, dear God, that have things on their heart, dear God. We know that we are dealing with sickness, dear Heavenly Father. We deal with bereavement, dear God, and we just deal with life issues, dear Heavenly Father, that sometimes causes us to fall short, dear Heavenly Father, or to doubt and not have faith in you the way that we should, dear Heavenly Father, knowing that you are great, dear Heavenly Father, and you have created a new us, dear Heavenly Father, a new man. And if we just pray, dear Heavenly Father, we'll continue to walk in the way that you will continue to protect us, dear God. We pray for your continued grace and mercy, and we just, again, thank you for your, just for all the blessings that you have bestowed upon us, dear God. We pray that as we move forward in this service, dear God, that all things will be about you, dear Heavenly Father, and not about us, dear God, and that you will get all the glory and all the praise. This is our prayer we ask in your Son Jesus' name. Let us all say, amen.
Amen.
Well, it's in my veins, Lord, it's in my veins, you know it's in my veins, Lord, it's in my veins. While the blood is running on, way down in my veins, Lord, it's in my, yes, it's in my veins, Lord, it's in my veins, you know it's in my veins, Lord, it's in my veins, while the blood is running on, way down in my veins, Lord, it's in my veins, and now I'm gonna sing just a little over here, and I'm gonna sing just a little over there, while the blood is running along way down in my veins, Lord, it's in my, yes, it's in my veins, Lord, it's in my veins, you know it's in my veins, Lord, it's in my veins, while the blood is running way down in my veins, the Lord is in my veins, and now I'm gonna shout just a little over here, and I'm gonna shout just a little over there, while the blood is running warm way down in my veins, the Lord is in my, yes, it's in my veins, the Lord is in my veins, in my vein, Lord, it's in my, while the blood is running along way down in my, Lord, it's in my vein. Good morning, Cedar Valley. Y'all doing okay this morning? You still bundled up, so I know you're cold, so if you sing a little bit, that'll warm you up this morning. Alright? Hallelujah, singing, Lord, hallelujah. Well, I've been running ever since I made a start. Oh, and you know that my days are bright. Jesus gonna make me my burdens. And don't you know that there's a love is above the hanging over in my, yes, in my, everybody sing now, hallelujah, glory, hallelujah. Well, I've been a running ever since I made a start. Oh, and you know that my days are bright. Jesus gonna make with my burdens. And don't you know that there's a love is above everything, you know that love is above. And don't you know that my love is bubbling over in my, yes, in my heart. Amen. We'll sing a couple of verses of Make Me a Servant, after which we will have our scripture reading and prayer. Make me a servant, Lord, make me like you, for you are a servant. to make me a servant. Make me. Let's sing that verse again. Make me a servant, Lord, make me like you, for you are a servant, make me one too, make me a servant, do what you must do.
Luke chapter 13, verses 10 through 13. And it reads, "Now he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath, and behold, there was a woman who had a spirit of infirmity 18 years, and was bent over and could in no way raise herself up. But when Jesus saw her, he called her to him and said to her, 'Woman, you are loosed from your infirmity.' And he laid his hands on her, and immediately she was made straight and glorified God." I've read to you Luke chapter 13, verses 10 through 13. May we stand for prayer.
Let us go to our Heavenly Father in a word of prayer. To the great God Jehovah, to the God that said, "Let there be light," and there was light. To the God that formed man from the dust of the earth and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. To the God that did all these things and thought it not robbery to wake us up this morning. Father, we just want to say thank you for granting us the gift of life. Father, we want to say thank you for sustaining us, not just today, but Father, throughout our entire lives. Father, we're just so thankful. We're so grateful that you allowed us to come to this place. Father, appreciative that we could have been dead sleeping in our graves. But you allowed us to come to the house of worship and praise, and for that we say thank you, Lord. Father God, we're just so grateful, and we're just so thankful for all the manifold blessings you bestowed upon us. Father, you put food in our bellies. You put clothes on our backs. Father, you've given us transportation to take us to and from where we need to go. Father, it is not us. It is not us who, we cannot even take care of ourselves. It's you who have sustained us and kept us. Father God, we just ask you to be with those who are sick and those who are struggling with illness right now. Father, those who might even be sitting here in our audience on tonight, this morning, Father, dealing with sickness, Father, those who are in hospitals and nursing homes, place your healing hands upon them. Heal them of their infirmities that they might be able to gain strength to be able to give you praise and honor for the healing they've received. Father God, for those that are traveling right about now, Father, those who are on the dangerous highways, who are in the airways, Father, just be with them and just protect them as they go from one destination to the next. Father, we're just so thankful for this congregation and all the things that we are preparing to do in this year, this end of this year and the beginning of the next. Father God, we ask you to give us strength. We ask you to give us fortitude. But most of all, Father, give us the spirit of unity that we might continue to work together to make this congregation what it should be. Father God, we ask you to be with our manservant, Brother Bailey, as he prepares to mount the gospel plow this morning. Father, may the word that he preached sink deep into our hearts. May it prick some soul on this morning that they might ask the grand old question,
What must I do in order to be saved? Amen. And Father God, when we have done all that we can do in this life and must prepare for the life to come, when we must go into that room to come out no more, Father, when we must lay our head upon that dying pillow, Father, as we cross over Chile, Jordan, we just ask for three things: a mansion, a robe, and a crown. And Father, this will be enough. In the name of the one who walked on the boisterous waters and calmed the raging sea, in the name of the one who died on the cross to give us liberty, it is in his precious name we pray and ask it all. Let us all in the assembly say, Amen.
Amen. Lord, hold my hand while I run this race. And oh, Lord, hold my hand, yes, while I run this race. And oh, Lord, hold my hand while I run this race. Because I don't want to run this race in a vain. This race in a vain, and oh Lord, guide my feet while I run this race, and oh Lord, guide my feet, yeah, while I run this race, and oh Lord, guide my feet while I run this race. Because I don't want to run this race in a vain, this race in a, and oh Lord, help me to live right while I run this race, and oh Lord, help me to live right while I run this race, and oh Lord, help me to live right while I run this race. Because I don't want to run this race in vain, this race in vain.
Good morning. As we prepare for Squadron Service Communion, I'll be taking the scriptures out of 1 Corinthians chapter 16. I'm in scripture used to get us prepared and also show us where we are commanded to give to the Lord's church. Verse number 1 states in chapter 16, now concerning the collection for the saints that I've given over to the church of Galatia, even so be ye upon the first day of the week, let every one of you lay by in store as God has prospered him, that there be no doubt.
Basis. Praise God. 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 All right, soprano. Praise God. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye land. Serve the Lord, serve him with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we, though we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, and his mercy is everlasting. And his truth endureth to all generation. Thank you, Jesus. 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 Thank you, thank you, Jesus. Yeah. Hallelujah. Sing it.
like you mean it. All right, let's warm up. Come on. Hallelujah, glory, hallelujah. Hallelujah, glory, hallelujah. Hallelujah, glory, hallelujah. One more time, hallelujah. Let me hear it. Come on, sing it now. Hallelujah, glory, hallelujah. Hallelujah, glory, hallelujah.
Who has believed our message? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a tender shoot, and like a root out of parched ground, he has no stately form or majesty that we should look upon him, no appearance that we should be attracted to him. He was despised and forsaken of men, and a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, like one from whom men hide their face. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely our grief he himself bore, and our sorrows he carried. Yet we ourselves esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was pierced through for our transgressions. He was cursed for our iniquities. The chastening of our well-being fell upon him. And by his scourging, we are healed. All of us, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way. But the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. He was oppressed and he was afflicted. Yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is laid to slaughter, and like a sheep that is silent before its shears, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and as his and for his generation who considered, he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgressions of my people, to whom the stroke was due, his grave was assigned with wicked men. Yet he was with a rich man in his death, because he had done no violence, nor was there any deceit in his mouth. But the Lord was pleased to crush him, putting him to grief. If he would render himself as a guilty offering, he will see his offspring. He will prolong his days, and the good pleasure of the Lord will prosper in his hand. As a result of his anguish of his soul, he will see it and be satisfied. By his knowledge, the righteous one, my servant, will justify the many, as he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great, and he will divide the booty with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he himself bore the sins of many. He interceded for the transgressors. I have read Isaiah 53.
Hallelujah.
And I will pray.
a couple more selections, after which we will have our message for this morning. We'll sing I Keep Falling in Love with Him, and then the last song is going to be Sing Praises. I keep falling in love with Him over and over and over, over again. And I keep falling in love with Him over and over and over, over again. And if He gets sweeter and sweeter as the days go by, oh, well, between my God and I keep falling in love with Him over and over and over and over again. And He keeps blessing me over and over and over and over, over again. And He keeps blessing me over and over and over and over, over again. And He gets sweeter and sweeter as the days go by. Oh, what a love between my God and I keep falling in love with Him over and over and over and over again. And He keeps cleansing me over and over and over and over, over again. And He keeps cleansing me over and over and over and over. Yes, and He gets sweeter and sweeter as the days go by. Oh, what a love between my God and I keep falling in love with Him over and over and over and over again. And I keep falling in love with Him over and over and over, over again. And I keep falling in love with Him over and over and over, over again. And He gets sweeter, sweeter as the days go by. Oh, well, between my God and I keep falling in love with Him over and over and over again. Amen. He gets sweeter and sweeter as the days go by. Come on and sing, yes, yeah, sing. Come on and sing, yes, yeah, sing. Because we love the Lord. Come on and sing. Yeah, you sound good, brother. Stand up, brother. Let me see. Come on, stand up.
Yes, yeah, sing. Because we love.
One more time, basses. Come on and sing.
Some of us were still trying to figure out where we were this morning. Some of us were still trying to figure out why we got out of the bed to face the cold. But it is for a good reason. And you're going to get up tomorrow, so you might as well get on up today. And come out to the house of the Lord and worship God. Such a blessing this morning to be in a place where the spirit is high. And I don't know about you, I don't want to be around dead things, dead people. I only like to go in the cemetery to visit for moments, for it is a reminder that I'm going that way and I'm not in any rush to get into the grave. You got an eternity to be dead. You ought to be alive, and we ought to be lively stones, and we ought to have the Spirit of God in us on this morning. So we want to thank Brother Day as well as all of the brothers who have collectively led us in our service today. And I know we often say worship, but I contend that you ought to have been worshiping God every single day of your life. And everywhere you go, everything you do ought to be centered around our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To our visitors, again, you are our honored guests, and we're so glad to have you. I don't know if some of you may be traveling in or visiting, if this is your first time or your returning time, or maybe if you're one of those that we have among us who are visiting and you're considering Cedar Valley your church home. We pray that you would indeed consider us, and I believe that God is taking us places. I don't know where he's taking us, and history will tell that, but we're trusting in him, and wherever he takes us, we in turn will turn around and give God the glory. And thank God that we have one more Sunday left in the year. And thank God if you allow to almost make it to the end of the year. We're not quite to 17 yet, but I'm blessed that I've been able to make it thus far. You know what? I got to eat this year. Thank God for that, you know. Thank God for eating this year. I thank God for shelter and clothing. And, you know, somebody ought to shout if you didn't visit the hospital this year. Yeah, you ought to thank God this morning. I know you might not have no gifts under the tree, but all your faculties are in place, right? And God has shown favor on you, and God has given us all favor this morning. And so it has been a wonderful year. And as I said last week, if you don't like some of the results that you got in 2016, all you got to do is start doing things differently, changing some habits and behaviors. I'm learning in life that nobody feels sorry for you. And the Lord don't feel sorry for you, because the Lord has given you everything you need to be successful. And whatever spirit that has encapsulated you, that has caused you to fear or be afraid, you got to loose that spirit and keep your faith and trust in God. We want to welcome, if we have any college students who are back home, we're glad to have you home as well. And we pray that you've had a wonderful semester, and that you always remember that you go to college to get an education. and you can set up your life. We want to encourage you to come out on Wednesday night. We need all of y'all here, and I say this because I often sometimes ponder that we can have a house full on Sunday morning, and when we get ready to do other activities, people disappear. I don't know where everybody goes. I wonder where is all our membership. But this Wednesday night, we're going to have our year-end program, and really we're going to have a few small messages, some singing, and a chili cook-off. Now, I don't have a lot of contestants this year. I think I have one. So I don't know what happened to the chili cook-off. This is supposed to be our 7th annual, but we still need you to bring some chili, some crackers, some cheese. I guess whether y'all eat onions. What else do you put on? Fritos. Whatever you want to bring. And we're just going to have a good time eating. Now, if we don't have any chili, that's not on me, okay? I'm saying let's bring it. We always do it something that's not very formal. So we need you to bring it. And we're just going to have a fellowship time. And also we'll have a PowerPoint, which will have a video presentation of all of the events that we've done throughout the course of the year. And I think what's unfortunate is that many of you who are sitting in here this morning, you don't get to witness half of the things that go on through the year. I promise you, if you only are here on Sunday mornings, you don't see half of the good things that go on. And a lot of the experiences and the joys that is part of being part of a membership. And so I encourage you to dig a little deeper and go a little further to try to get a deeper, more commitment. And you'll see that it is good. I told my kids, I don't just stay home for no reason. If you see me, if the doors are open and I'm in good health and a right frame of mind, I'm going to be there. Unless something providentially hinders me. As I said last week, I thought I was going to make it to the marriage fellowship, but we had a little bump and couldn't make it. But God has blessed us to be here, and God has blessed me every Sunday this year, unless homecoming was here to stand and proclaim the good news. And I'm thankful to God that he kept me healthy, wasn't out sick, was able to make it here and to be able to, y'all don't know how challenging it can be sometimes to try to keep it fresh for y'all. And sometimes you feel like you are preaching the same thing, but you know what? The Bible is true every week. We could preach the same sermon every week and it would still be true. So I'm blessed this morning. I was just reflecting, thankful to God to make it another year. And if you really are a student of the Word, you realize that you will never run out of things to teach or preach or study because the Bible is so enriching. And then we want to encourage you today, if you can, if you got a little bit of time out of your day to do something for somebody else, come with us to the nursing home. And you ought to see how wonderful it is to sing to some of those individuals who are in the nursing home. And they may not even know a lot of their family members, but they do know the words, the Jingle Bells. And it's amazing. You can be 90 years old and not forget Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. And we get to speak to them and talk to them. And I always think about when I go to the nursing homes and hospitals, I'm reminded that that could be me one day. And I would want someone to come and visit me. And I think sometimes we shoot out, and some of y'all are going to shoot out and disappear, but you're not even going nowhere but to the house. You know, and you could take a few minutes out of your day to brighten someone else's day. And I think if we start getting our minds that we're servants, and every opportunity as an opportunity to serve, and ask yourself the question. Somebody says, Brother Bailey, you trying to make me feel bad? No, your own conscience is making you feel bad. I'm just trying to put it on your conscience that you've got to do more and participate more than just on being a Sunday morning attendant. And I wouldn't be worth my salt or doing my job if I did not say those things or put those things on our mind. And so be mindful that one day that will be you in the nursing home. And every time I drive over there or go to the hospital or visit someone, and every once in a while I'm walking in a hospital, and I'll just stop in a room with somebody that I don't even know and ask them, do they need prayer? And you'd be surprised how many people say that I didn't even realize that we needed prayer. You know, and sometimes we can be so wrapped up in ourselves. And I'll tell you this, if you're depressed this morning or you're underneath your circumstances or you're sad or got so much going on in your life, all you got to do is when you leave here, go to an ICU at any hospital, and you'll find that your situation is not as bad as it could be or that it could have been. And so this morning, we're thankful to God for that. We are going along in our series on the, y'all help me out, what's our series? The Phenomenal Woman. The Phenomenal Woman. Somebody said, you need to go to nursing home pretty soon. But the phenomenal woman, and it's been a blessing to stand before you and to be able to share with some of the extraordinary stories of some women of the Bible. We started off with Hagar and Sarah. We were talking about two struggling women. One woman tried to jump ahead of God. One woman who was mistreated, who understood that God sees. Then we looked at Judge Deborah. She was the epitome. We talked about of a woman. She was a mother, like a mother to Israel. She was a warrior. She was a leader. She was a wife. She was a poet. And she was a prophetess, one who listened to the voice of God that stood as a medium between God and his people. And she was fearless. And then we talked about last week the endangered woman. And she is the virtuous woman, one who excels, who is excellent, who understands that charm is deceitful and beauty is vain. And she's one that praises the Lord, who her husband, the heart of her husband, does safely trust in her, and her children rise up and call her blessed. Then we talked about Sunday night, the ideal woman, and Peter talks about this woman as one who is submissive to God and who has allowed herself to exercise her strength in submission to God and to her family, and also that she is married to a man who's submissive to God also, and they submit to one another in fear of the Lord. And the children obey their parents in the Lord, for this is right, and God is pleased with that type of family. And then today I want to look at the changed woman. The changed woman. Is there anybody in here that has been changed? Is there anybody in here this morning that has a testimony? Is there anybody in here this morning who has a story to tell? The text we looked at this morning was in Luke chapter 13 and verse number 10. And I'm going to go through this real fast because I don't have a lot of time this morning. I'm thinking this morning that many of us have had an encounter with church, but we haven't had an encounter with Christ. Someone once said that time heals all wounds, and I believe that is one of the biggest lies that anybody ever told. Time does not heal all wounds. If that's the case, why do we have some people in our society, maybe some of you in here, who had some stuff happen to you 10, 15, 20 years ago, and you were never able to bounce back? And time does not heal wounds. And y'all heard me say this the past few weeks. Time is neither constructive nor destructive. In other words, time is not on your side in particular. Time is on the side of those who take advantage of it. You can use your time wisely. You can redeem the time, or you can squander away your time. But one thing that we all understand is that time, it does not wait for anyone. That is true. But time does not heal all wounds. And some of us really need to look deep within our hearts this morning as we get ready to close out this year. And next week we're going to end on Mary, the mother of Jesus. And I think that's going to be appropriate on Christmas. I believe she's a very extraordinary woman. But some of us need to really look deep within our hearts and really come to grips with that, is that time has not healed us. Why is it that you're still struggling with the same issues of 10 and 15 and 20 years ago? And what's even more depressing in some cases is that some of us have been born again believers. We've been in the church. We've been around the church. We've heard sermons. We've been in ladies' Bible classes. We've been to workshops and seminars and retreats. But when we go out in public, we smile, we dress up, we look good. But when we come home and come to our houses and to our homes, and internally, we are defeated. We are still frustrated. We are still rehashing everything that has happened to us. And I believe the problem is you're confused with what you have actually done, with what you actually wanted to do. Now, through the years, you wanted to change, but maybe you really didn't know how. Maybe you really haven't had a true encounter with Christ Jesus. Somebody said, what are you talking about this morning? I'm talking about a Saul-like encounter on the road to Damascus, where Jesus stops you in your tracks right where you are and confronts you about your current condition and redirects you and gives you another path and gives you another purpose. And you, like Paul, understand that because of who you were and because of now what you've become, There is nobody and no one but God, but Christ, who can do the things to a person's heart and change who they are but Christ. And I maintain this morning, and I'm going to confront your conscience and confront your excuses this morning, that the reason why you have not changed is because you truly have not had an encounter with Christ. Because the Bible in which I read, everybody who had an encounter with Christ, when they left Christ, they were not the same person they were before they came in contact with Christ. I wish I had somebody this morning. Who's been changed this morning? Just raise your hand a little bit. Oh, I got some real people in this morning. Hold them up a little bit. Show somebody that you've been changed. If you've been changed, you ought to have a good testimony. You ought not to be ashamed and afraid what God has done with you. In Luke chapter 13, I want to go through a few women. But with Luke chapter 13, we see a woman who had some infirmities and an infirmity with pain. And maybe you had some pain in your body. But Jesus is teaching in the synagogue, and we know that he's teaching on the Sabbath. And this woman, the Bible says, for 18 years, she's been bent over. And the Bible says she could not raise herself up. See, I'm talking to somebody this morning who's been trying to raise yourself up. You've been under the weight of your own infirmities and under the weight of your own circumstances, and it was not ever intended for you to raise yourself up. She tried to raise herself up, but she couldn't. Is there somebody here this morning who's been trying to raise yourself up? You've been trying to pull yourself together for 10 years and you're still trying to figure out why you can't get it together. It's because you have been trying to raise yourself up. She couldn't. And I like this. The Bible says Jesus saw her. It's like the man who was born blind. Jesus saw a man who could not see him. Aren't you glad this morning that Jesus saw you? That he looked at you and saw you? And I know he saw the condition of mankind, but aren't you glad this morning that he saw you? He saw exactly what you were going through. He saw when you were hurt. He saw the pain that you were in physically and mentally and emotionally. And he saw that you couldn't pick yourself up. But he came to you just when you needed him. And like me, I understand that the Lord is a Lord, a God of just in the nick of time. He'll come to you just when you needed him. And you were tied that knot at the end of the rope and you were hanging on. And when you think you could not raise yourself up, Jesus looked. Look right at you, because he wanted you to look back at him. And every Sunday morning when you come to church, in order to experience an encounter with God, you got to hear this word and walk out and be convinced that today is the day that I'm going to change. Who am I talking to this morning? Today has got to be the day that you change. Why go back to your house and get defeated and get under the covers and rehash your life situations and your problems? Get in contact with Jesus. He can get in your heart and cut loose all of that stuff that's been holding you back and weighing you down. I wish I had an audience on this morning. He called the woman. He said, "Woman, you are loose from your pain. You are loose from your problems. I'm going to free you from your problems." And the only reason why you're still held shackled to your problems is because you hadn't let me cut them loose. I'm the only one that can heal you. I'm the one that can cut you loose. And I'm talking to a woman this morning, maybe a man who's got some pain in your life. You got a lot of pain and somebody says, "I'm still hurt." My question is, why are you still hurt? It's because you have not had a real encounter with Jesus. Somebody said, "Somebody broke my heart." Well, Jesus would have healed your heart. Somebody said, "I got sorrow in my life." Well, Jesus would have given you joy. Somebody says, "I got a lot of pain in your heart," but Jesus would have given you something to shout about and given you happiness and peace and real perspective on life. And I think we need to go back to the drawing board and look at what we've really been doing in church all these years. Somebody says, "I've been reading the Bible, but I don't feel nothing." See, what we don't want true change. We don't want repentance. Well, we specialize in behavior modification. In other words, we take on things that'll help us temporarily. But let me tell you something. Somebody says, "I keep doing the same thing over and over again." You're not struggling. You just haven't repented. You know what repentance means? It's a change of mind. That means I walk away from it, never to return again. So if you keep going to something, you're going back and you're going back and forth, you haven't repented, you're struggling.
A lot of us don't even understand the difference between that, but it all depends on Christ gets in your heart. I've seen people stop things cold turkey all because Jesus Christ has gotten into their heart. And what Christ gets into your heart, he changes your desires. He changes your mindset. He changes how you feel about things. And you can look at people in the eye who have hurt you and mistreat you. And when Christ is in your heart, you'll see them, but you no longer hold the anxiety. You no longer hold the grudge. You no longer hold the bitterness because Christ has gotten into your heart. Saul was an assassin. Saul said he made havoc of the church. But when Christ got into his heart, he not only saw those that were lost, he realized that he was a debtor to Christ because of what he was doing and what Christ was now doing in him. I'm learning sometimes the best people for the kingdom are the messed up folks. Are the folks who've been in the street, are the folks who've done some things wrong, are the folks who've been in some pain. Some of us have been in so much comfort all of our lives, and if you've had a true encounter with Christ, you are not the same. You are not the same. The woman in John chapter 4, the Samaritan woman, she was a woman who represents many of us who are disoriented. You don't really know which direction that you're going. Jesus came in contact with this woman. Didn't Jesus say in John chapter 4, I got to go through Samaria. I got to see this woman. Why are we going through Samaria? I got to get there because there's somebody that I really need to see. I believe that God can look and say, there's somebody down in Lancaster, Texas that I got to get to see because I've been seeing what they're going through and they've been looking for love. Like the country song said, looking for love in all the wrong places. Looking for solutions in all the wrong places. Looking for solutions that don't solve and quick fixes and temporary escape from the realities of life. But Jesus came to this woman, a Samaritan woman. She even asked him the question, how do you, being a Jew, not only a Jew but a male, talk to me, a Samaritan woman? What Jesus was doing was Jesus was breaking all of the rules in order to bless this woman. Did I have anybody in here this morning that Jesus broke some rules to bless you? Have you gotten something that you didn't deserve? Maybe he put you in a job that you weren't really qualified for, or blessed you with a husband that you really didn't deserve, or gave you a family better than what you could ask for. God broke some rules to bless you. And he came to you where you were, and he changed what you thought and how you thought about everything. And he came to you and said, when you asked him, hey, can I have something to drink? Like this woman says, something to drink. He says, I got something for you. I got some living water. See, Jesus knew this woman was thirsty, both literally and figuratively. Thirsty woman. We got some thirsty women out here today. And Jesus is trying to offer you some living water. It will become in him, he says, a fountain. I'm gonna be through with y'all in a second. A fountain of water springing up on the inside into everlasting life. He changed what she thought about worship. He said, worship is not in this mountain and it's not in Jerusalem. God is looking for true worshipers, those that worship him in spirit and in truth. Let me tell you something that's going to bust your bubble this morning. You cannot be depressed and worship God at the same time. You cannot praise God and be depressed at the same time. You can't do it. Because the spirit of praise takes you out of yourself and it takes you to a higher level. And when you got the word of God in you, when the word of God is inside of you, it will spring up. It'll come up from the inside. And when you go through things, you got something to draw on and you got something to pull from. And then when Christ reorients you and puts you on a new path and gives you a new perspective on how things go, then you have a testimony. She ran through the village and she said, come see a man. I ain't talking about a man in the sense of the five and the six that I had. Those men, you know, I'm getting tired of them old men. They ain't doing nothing for me. But come see a real man. Come see the Son of God. And he told me everything that I ever had done. Yeah, I know that I went through some stuff, but now I got a testimony and I got to run and shout it from the hills that I've had an encounter with Christ Jesus. And not only am I sure about who I am, I'm sure about how to worship. I'm sure about who He is, and I'm sure that you need to know Him too. Yeah, this was a woman who didn't know where she was going, and we got a lot of young ladies right here and a lot of women who don't know where they are going. And if you had a true encounter with Christ, you would be sure this morning where you're going. You'll be sure about who He is. You would be sure that He's with you. You would be sure about the relationships you choose. You would be sure about raising your children. You would be sure about being committed to God. You'll be sure about worshiping God every single day. You would be sure about joy, sure about love, sure about gentleness, sure about meekness, sure about temperance. You're not sure because you have not had an encounter. You're in pain because you have not really touched Him and learned of Him. And when in Him, you got rest for your soul. Somebody say, you're just saying that because you're the preacher. No, I'm not saying that because I'm a preacher. I'm saying that because I know Him. And I've tried Him. And I've tested Him. And I've proved Him. And He's come through for me. And He's provided for me. And He's brought me out of some stuff. And He's corrected some of my thoughts. And He saved me from my sins, and His blood keeps cleansing me over and over and over again. And He stopped me in my tracks, and He saved me from what could have been some hellish and devilish situations. And I like Paul every day, oh, for grace. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus. Oh, for grace. Thank God that Jesus came through my town. Thank God that Jesus said, I got to get to Samaria. I don't know about everybody else in that particular city, but He says, I know about this woman. And I believe that she had some faith to believe in Jesus Christ. And think about Mark chapter 24. Jairus' daughter was dead, 12 years old. Jairus was the ruler of the synagogue. When he saw Jesus, he fell down at the seat. He came into the room. There was a lot of commotion and crying. And Jesus told him that this girl is not asleep. Not dead, but she's sleeping. He called her name and told her to rise. I want to talk. We got some sleeping women in here this morning. We got some sleeping people, sleeping Christians. And let me tell you something. You ain't dead. You just sleep. You need somebody to revive you. And when Jesus gets in your presence, everything that's dead, He can command everything that's dead to get up. You know, I sit here this morning and I'm watching, I look around, and I'm not just trying to look around and watch your worship. There's some people really having a difficult time, Brother Day, opening their mouth and singing, sing praises. Whatever it is, I don't know what you got. Whatever it is in life has got you pulled down so hard that you don't think it necessary to open your mouth and be a part of the worship. What is it? Y'all tell me, what do you have in your life right now that's so worse than what anybody else has got? Or that anybody else has been through? If you dead this morning spiritually in 2016, if you had a true encounter with Christ, you'll get up. Dead things don't move. Dead things are not responsive to the Word of God. You can hear the Word of God and it'll go in one ear and out the other. And I was listening to a message this week and I was driving in the car, Brother Johnson, and I had to pull over because my foot just kept doing this and I was like, I'm going to get in another accident because that Word was so good and it was inside of me and running through me because I'm not dead. The Spirit of God is in me, and when I heard the Spirit coming from that man preaching God's word, that Spirit connected with my spirit, and the Spirit of God is a lively spirit. And I said, I got some stuff to change. I got some stuff to work on. Christ, make me over. Do a little more with me. I want to know Him, as Paul says. I don't want to know about Him. I don't want to know the God that you know. I want to know Him for myself. I don't want to know Him because my mom and daddy know Him, or because the other preachers know Him, or because the elders know Him. I want Him to come into my heart, and every single day, no matter what I got going on in my life, I want you to look at that guy and say, he got a smile on his face, not because of what he's going through, because he's had a real encounter with Jesus Christ. And so therefore he's a changed man. From the inside out, I'm changed. I know I've been changed. I don't know about you this morning, but I know I've been changed. I know I'm not dead. Some of us need some CPR this morning. Some of our brothers say, I'll do it. No, we ain't talking about that type of CPR, but some spiritual resuscitation. Yeah, you're dead. You're just dead. You're on life support. You barely stumbled in here. You barely get through the week. You barely wake up. You barely smile. You barely praise. You barely shout. You barely give thanks. You are dead. If you had Christ in your life, couldn't be dead, Brother Johnson. You might not have nothing to put on the tree, but you're excited anyway. So I said, we ain't got no ham. I don't care. We'll have Christmas with sardines if that's what we got to do. We'll put them on a little plate, get some crackers and cheese, and we'll praise God for what we got. Oh, I'm thankful for what I got. God don't need to give me nothing else. He don't have to do another thing for me. He brought my kids back and forth to school every single day and brought them home. I know who I am. I'm in good health, and I love the Lord, and I know He lives in me. God don't have to give another thing for me. And even if I find myself in a low place, I don't believe the God I know allow me to stay in that place. I know He always comes to me when I need Him. And He raised a dead woman. He says, she ain't sleeping, she's dead. Some of you say, I'm just dead. No, you just sleeping. I'm spiritually, no, you're just there. But if you had a true encounter with Christ, He's telling you, and as He told the girl, He called her by name and said, get up. Yeah. And I'm calling somebody this morning, get up. That's the message the Lord's trying to say. Get up. I know you're sitting down right now, but in your mind, stand up. Dust off the circumstances that have been weighing you down and the excuses that have been holding you back and all of your emotional feelings, how you feel about everything. It's not about what you feel about what you're going through. It's about what Christ can do with what you're going through. Get out of your feelings. Can I say that before the year is over? Your feelings can be so deceptive. We live in a society that says just because I feel it, it means it's true. I'm just feeling a certain way. You know what? Life don't care how you feel. Hold on, let me tell you a funny. You think the devil care how you feel? You don't feel good today. Matter of fact, the devil wants you to stay in that bed. The devil wants you to miss church. The devil wants you to be depressed. The devil wants you to have anxiety and fear. The devil wants you to hold that bitterness. He wants you to hold that grudges. He wants you to not read your Bible. Not serve. He wants that. He was on the way. He stopped. Well, he was on his way to see Jerry, his daughter. He raised that. But in between that story, there was a woman who was suffering with some issues. 12 years. She was bleeding. According to the Levitical law, she was unclean. Bible says she suffered many things from many physicians. She spent all that she had, and instead of getting better, she got worse. Anybody ever been there? Where you went to the wrong place looking for answers? You went to a man thinking he was going to make you better, but he made you worse. You went to the bottle thinking you were going to feel better, but it made you worse. You went to the blunt thinking you was going to get high enough to forget about your problems, but when you came down, your bills were still due and you still didn't have a man. After you done freed yourself from your problems and taken yourself away, your reality is going to look at you square in the face and say, deal with me. I'm here. This is what happened to you. This is who you are. This is your issues. 12 years. And because she suffered long enough, let me stop this. If you suffered long enough, someone said, you are sick and tired of getting sick and tired this morning, you'll be running to Jesus. No matter what everybody thinks about you, they can call you unclean. They can X you out and isolate you, but you'll risk it. This woman said, I don't know if I can just make my way through the crowd and get to Jesus. I said, I've been suffering long enough, and so it don't matter even if it doesn't happen, but I believe it will. She said, he don't even have to say nothing to me. He don't have to look at me. He don't have to say, woman, you've been made whole. I just want to get the tip of his garment because I believe there's something there that'll make me whole, that'll get me right, because I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. I'm sick and tired of suffering with my issues. 12 years. See, time don't heal all wounds. Time don't heal all pain. She heard about Jesus, got to his clothes, and the Bible says when she touched him, immediately he knew. And he said, see, when you run to Jesus, he knows. Some of us, I ain't got the Lord, I don't feel him this morning, because you ain't gone to him. If you really had him, you would know it. You would feel it. You would feel real power in your life. You would feel it. And I wish I could say it. I wish I could let somebody feel it this morning, that you would have real power in your life. I never read where Jesus made anybody do anything. Jesus is not going to make you well. He's not going to make you whole. He's not going to make you happy. He's not going to give you peace unless you want it. Unless you want it. Unless you believe that he is all in all. You are fulfilled in Christ. There is no need for another. Your wife can't give it to you. Your job can't give it to you. Prestige and money and status and fame and fortune cannot give it to you. Living to be 150 years old cannot give it to you. It only comes from having a real encounter with Jesus Christ. And look what Jesus says to her. He says, it is your faith. It wasn't nothing in the garment. It was the faith that I saw. And y'all heard me say it before. This would be like me looking out in the audience and saying, 250 people looking at me, and I'm saying, somebody saw me. Somebody's looking at me. But he knew it. He knew it. He knows who's desperate for him. And he know who playing church, and he know who really want him. See, coming to church has messed some of us up, because we think the only place we can find Christ is at church. Well, you need to find him at church, but at church is where you express collectively to one another what he's been doing for me all week long. All week long. I'm telling you, Brother Day, y'all didn't have to call me to worship. I didn't have to pray to get my mind right to enter into the sanctuary. I was with him on Monday. He was rolling with me on Tuesday. I was on my knees talking to him on Wednesday. He came to me and gave me peace on Thursday. I had to pray about some things on Friday. Yesterday I got up with him on my mind. And this morning we just rolled right into it, ready to go. And thank God for another opportunity to talk about how good you are in my life. You ain't got to get me ready to do that, because I know him for myself. And I feel him in my spirit and in my soul, and in him I live and move and have my very being. And so sometimes I get down, but I can't stay down for too long, because Jesus will pick me right now. I say, don't do it. When I fall down, like that kid who falls down and scrapes his knees, he gets me up and stands me on my 2 feet. Says, stand up. Martin Luther King said, nobody can ride your back unless it's bent. We giving everybody piggyback ride. And we falling down. We even letting the devil ride on our back. Because you're giving him an opportunity. You've given him place. Bible says, resist the devil and he'll flee from you. See, I stopped fooling with the devil. I started turning him over to God. All of my thoughts, bringing them into captivity, into subjection and obedience unto Christ, pulling those thoughts in. When I see something that I know goes against the word of God, I got to pull it back in. Because you'll think yourself right out of your faith, right out of what you believe in. And then some of us are guilty of being overthinkers. We overthink everything. Well, what if this happens? Well, if this happens, then that's going to happen. If that happens, this going to happen. And I'm just doomed. James says, if you're going to ask and waver, don't expect to receive anything from the Lord. If you ain't sure about him not being able to do it, that's probably why you don't have it. Somebody says, what? I'm sure. I beg the difference. Go home and really think about it. Are you really sure that he can do it? Two other men in John chapter 11. Two grieving women. Do we have any women in here who've lost someone they love? Can I say, raise your hand if you lost someone you love. Hold on. You're not alone. Sometimes we think, I'm the only one that's lost somebody. No, everybody's lost somebody. And that's left a void in their hearts. That don't mean you can't keep living. That don't mean stop living. That don't mean you can't go on in life. It's going to happen to all of us sooner or later. You think about Job chapter 1. The Bible says Satan, he came to God and he says, you know, what about Job? Have you considered Job? Yeah, you know, God said, well, Job is a righteous man, one that fears me, you know, avoids evil. And Satan's argument to God was that Job fears you because of what he's received, because he's been blessed. Here's what you do. Take away his stuff and see how much he loves you. Take away his support system. Take away his rock. Take away his blessing and see how Job reacts to you. What Satan was challenging in our own minds and our hearts is what he was saying is, you got some things taken away from you. Whether it be that person you lost or the God that gave them to you. When we take on God. One of the tragedies in life is when people lose people, they never quite recover. They never quite recover, and they spend the rest of their lives, instead of living out the brevity of time that we have, they spend the rest of their lives unhealthily grieving people whom they lost. Y'all know about grief, that it's healthy for a period of time, but if it gone too long, it's unhealthy. But we do both extremes. We either we don't deal with our losses, or we let it go on too long. We do that with a lot of things. We don't deal with it as it happens. In other words, look at me and say, I lost my daddy. I lost my mama. I lost my grandmother who raised me. I lost my child, and it hurts. It has put a burning hole in my heart, and I'm hurt, and I'm sad, and I'm disappointed. I know they've gone on to be with the Lord, but it hurts. Some of us come out the box. They don't get the body good in the ground. I'm good. I'm cool. They're blessing with the Lord. They're gone with the Lord. They with Jesus. No, good and well, you in pain. And then some of us, 25 years later, it's just like the same day they went into the ground. You got to grieve, but you got to do it right. Jesus came across two women, Mary and Martha, who were grieving. He wanted them to understand that he was the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And these words not only went to Mary and Martha that they might have hope in the resurrection, but it ought to give some of us hope today that if your loved one has gone on, realize that if they believed in Christ Jesus and they obeyed the gospel, they have not ceased to exist, but they live. And live your life in such a way that we can see that great cloud of witnesses who's cheering us on, encouraging us to lay aside all the weight and sin that does so easily beset us. Doing this so that they can believe. That they believe that not only can I resurrect someone, but I am the resurrection. I am the resurrection. Do you believe in that this morning? Somebody who's tied to your grief and your loss is weighing you down. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the resurrection? I know I'm sounding like I'm at a funeral this morning, but do you believe that Christ is the resurrection? And your loved one is with the Lord, and you got to turn even your losses over to God because your losses can weigh you down. They'll weigh you down. Someone says, I've seen people who never recovered. Listen, you're going to look up 1 second and you're going to be dead. Can I sober this audience up this morning? Death is coming for all of us. Someone once said, you come to church to learn how to die. You know what? You're here this morning just to learn how to die. Somebody says, I ain't learning how to die. Well, you're learning how to live. And how you live is how you're going to die. And how you die is how you're going to get up. And depending on how you get up, depends on where you're going. You can't afford to be bogged down too much in this life. You only got a short period of time with your kids at home. Stop complaining about having kids. Pretty soon they're going to be up and gone, and you're going to wish they're going to come home. Stop complaining about it. Stop complaining about everything. Nobody wants to hear that. Can I say that again? Some people are really going through some stuff. We don't want to hear about all your problems all of the time. If you're going to talk to someone who can help you, but just to be venting, take it to the Lord. I got two more people, and then I know y'all want me to be done. There was a woman in John chapter 8 who had an encounter. Anybody, this is probably the one nobody wants to raise their hand. Anybody ever has a situation in your life that brought you shame? Thank God. We got some honest folks. You know, shame says, I want to cover my head. Because either what I've done or what someone else has done to me has caused me embarrassment or shame. Many people have been the victims of abusers, and they have the shame in their lives as if they were the ones who did it. But certain situations, certain acts of violence and abuse, neglect cause shame. Sometimes we make some bad choices in our youth that bring us shame. Sometimes we step outside of what we know to be true. Sometimes we just didn't know. If some of us being honest, we just didn't even know any better. Because we take for granted, everybody that got kids aren't raising kids. Yeah, some of us, our parents, God bless them, bless their soul, but they really didn't really tell us how to do stuff. Because, you know, and don't be them type of parent, be like, certain type of talks I can't have with my kids. Well, if you don't have them, somebody else is going to have them with them. There's going to be a young man in school. I can't talk to my daughter because it's embarrassing. Well, that young man, he texting her. He's having a talk with her on InstaSnap. He's telling her everything you couldn't because you was embarrassed. And I'm too ashamed to talk to my kids about what I done. Why? Maybe you can help them avoid some of the same pitfalls. Why are you still ashamed if you come in contact with Jesus? See, a person who's really come in contact with Jesus can no longer carry shame, because what they do is they recognize that everything that has happened to them, God has allowed it to, but Christ Jesus has now delivered them from the shame. The woman in John chapter 8 was brought out. She was an adulteress. Have you ever had a private problem go public? See, it's one thing to be struggling private, but have you ever had your private business go public? See, the difference between some of us who are on the list that nobody thinks does nothing wrong, and the other ones is that think about it. All of us have done some stuff, and we don't know it all because you just didn't get caught. This woman got caught. That's the only difference between her and half the people standing there, but Jesus knew it. And they caught her. Can you imagine what kind of shame that is? And let me tell you something, church. We are not in the business of dragging people up and making a spectacle over them. But we are in the business of hearing and seeing how God has transformed your life. Private problem becomes a public spectacle. But Jesus stooped down, as I said before, and he became the lowest person in the room. And see, I like this because he can convict the conscience of your accusers. You don't have to do it. You don't have to turn on another person and remind them of what they've done. And the Bible says in verse number 9 of that chapter, it was just Jesus and that woman alone in the room. When's the last time you've really been alone with Jesus? Just you and Jesus alone. And he told the woman, I do not condemn you. Where are your condemners? Go and sin no more. I don't condemn you, but I do not condone your behavior. That's what makes grace so good, is that God still has in mind everything that you've ever done and chooses to call you out, chooses to sanctify you, chooses to justify you, chooses to wash you, and still calls you a son and daughter. And he knows exactly what you was doing. He was watching you on the street and in the club. I don't know what you was doing. He was watching you. He knew everything you ever done. And that's why, again, I always say, I ain't got to be fake with nobody. God knows everything I ever thought, everything I ever done, everything I wanted to do and did not do. Some of us are saved because we wanted to do some stuff, but God stopped us. You were just like Saul on the road to Damascus, and God stopped you right in your track. I tell y'all this before. I always joke about my mom in college. Every time I thought I wanted to do something, she called, ring, hold up the bloodstained banner. How was Bible class today? Where was church? I'm like, I can't do nothing. But you know what I realize now? It wasn't my mama. It was God working through her. With every temptation, he always makes a way to escape. But you know what? Sometimes we don't want that way. Because that way is harder than actually yielding in. That way is hard way, because that means I might have to deny myself and die to myself. He says, I don't condone your behavior, but I don't condemn you. I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. You don't walk in darkness. There's nothing to be ashamed of. There's nothing to be ashamed of this morning. Why are we so tied up with what everybody will think about us? Why is it? As we pretend like we're not sinners, we parade in our righteousness all of the time, and we can be no good use to anybody. For those of you who aren't as comfortable or familiar with church, and you think that we're just a place of perfect people, that's not true. That's farthest from the truth. Matter of fact, all of us are people in need of a true encounter with Christ. And lastly, before I close, I'd like to think about the woman who the Bible describes as a sinner in Luke chapter 7. She had an alabaster box. And she was a desperate woman. She had a rep. She brought the alabaster box with fragrance, and the Bible says that she stood behind Jesus at his feet. She cried profusely. Is there anybody in here who's ever cried because of your sins? Or because of the sins of others that have been projected upon you? Bible says she cried so much. Have you ever cried that hard that you can wash somebody's feet with your tears? Yeah, that wasn't just a drop. Some of us fake cry real good, even getting stuff coming out. But have you ever poured out your heart such godly sorrow and remorse and contriteness? She washed his feet with her tears, took her hair and wiped her feet. Now, if somebody was doing that for me, y'all would think that was some suspect stuff. If y'all saw somebody crying at my feet and wiping their hair, what's going on at that church? One thing I like about Jesus, he wasn't afraid to help people based on what other folks were thinking. You know, Jesus was around so many women, but he was never accused of anything. She kissed his feet. That's when we really would have lost it. She made him smell good. She bought him some cologne. And look what the Pharisee said in verse number 39. If this man were a prophet, he would know what kind of woman this is that's touching him. She's a sinner. Let me tell you, that's the only kind of folks that need to touch Jesus. Sinners. That's all of us. All of us. From the pulpit to the back door to the parking lot to the White House, the Black House, the crack house, the outhouse. Sinners. Saved by grace. Through faith in Christ Jesus. When you look out at the condition of humanity, you got to see yourself. Look what Jesus says in verse number 44. Look what he says. He turned to the woman and said to Simon. Look at this. He turned to the woman and said to Peter, do you see this woman? I've entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet. But she has washed my feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head. You gave me no kiss, but this woman has not ceased to kiss my feet. Then he goes on to tell a parable. He talks about a creditor. And he says, if a man has been given $50, we'll use, put it in our terms, $50 and $500, and the creditor comes back and forgives both of them, which one will be more excited? It says the one who had to be have more forgiven. If you had $500 forgiven of you and this person only had $50, you ought to be a little bit more excited. Yeah. Yeah. We would think something's wrong with you. In other words, this person forgave you a debt of $500. But so often what happens in our lives, the person with $50 acts more excited than the person with $500. But it ought to be, if you got a long track record and a history of stuff in your life that you're not a proud of and that you're not ashamed of, and a history of misuse and abuse and shame and family destructive cycles and bad decision making, you ought to be excited about what Christ can do for you. Amen. And then it just, and I think the thing that Christ does for us and has done for me more than anything else is what I realize, when he's in your heart, he changes your desires. Things that you might see other people want, you don't have a desire for them. Somebody says, what do you do when you get worried? Well, when Christ in my heart, I worry less. What do you do when you got anxiety? I don't suffer from anxiety. He said, be anxious for nothing. Somebody said, what do you do when you're back against the wall? I pray. I pray without ceasing. Somebody says, what about the things you can't control? I can't control them. Well, what about somebody do something? I can be reconciled with the things you can control or things you can't control and stop worrying about the things you can't. I can't control how you looked at me, how you rolled your eyes. You can't control that person who misused you or abused you or that person who raised you. You can't control all that. You can't control what you happened to you. You can't go back and change it. It's just part of your story. But this morning I'm calling for any young ladies who want to be changed. Suffering. Maybe you're just desperate. Maybe you're just thirsty and don't know it. Maybe you don't even know where you're going because nobody's really telling you what you ought to be and how you ought to go. Maybe you're just spiritually and emotionally dead. Maybe you just got a lot of shame on your plate. And sometimes that keeps us from saying, I can't be a godly woman because I've done too much. I promise you, you ain't going to hear me throwing it back up. Why are you going to do that? Because I'm trying to be like Jesus. Jesus just said, stop it. Stop it. I have a song they're going to play for me. And as we think about this, I was thinking about this all week. And this is one of my favorite renditions of it. I want you to just listen to it for a second, and then we're going to go. It's a song we all know, but if I told you this morning that you don't have to do anything special to gain special favor with him, but just be obedient to the call that he has on your life. I'm calling somebody who says that, you know, we talked about the virtuous woman last week, but some people heard that and went back and did the same stuff. But I'm talking about a real encounter that when you walk out of this building today, y'all with me?
Yeah.
It is possible that you can walk out of this building today never to be the same woman. It happens on Sundays all across. It's possible that you could come in this building today and go down in that water, young man, some man, I don't know, and have all of your sins washed away. Everything that you've done being covered in the blood of the Lamb, and Christ was mindful of you when they put the crown of thorns upon his head. He was mindful of the mistakes that you would make when they put the scarlet robe around him and mocked him and scourged him and beat him and spat upon him. He was mindful of you. Now it's time for you to be mindful of Him. He's been mindful of you all this time, and He preserved your life, and He allowed you some time. Now it's time, while you got a little time left, to rededicate your life and give it all to Him. You've tried the world. You've tried sin. You've tried everything that the world has to offer. I need somebody this morning to stand up and tell me what the world's got to give you. Somebody, have you been in the world? Come on, I need somebody who's a champion of the world to stand up and tell me how good it is being in the streets. Tell me what kind of sleep you can get at night when you're all over the place. Tell me. But if you know Jesus, you'll sleep like a baby. Your conscience will be clear. You can love some people who's hard to love. You can let some stuff go. You can see life for how it really is. You can love your enemies. You can go the extra mile. You can go turn the other cheek. You can exercise faith in your speech. You can be a positive person. And most importantly, you can see that there are other people that need the Christ that you found. Calling all sisters, young sisters, who know you got some things that your mama don't see and your mama don't know. They just in your head that you know that they're there, you got to change. You better change it because it'll catch up with you. A lot of bad women were just bad girls with bad behaviors, bad habits that nobody corrected. Same thing with men. We were just taught by bad men. Man gonna do what a man gonna do. Stand wide-legged and be a man. Ain't what you tell a young man. You follow Christ, raise the bar, raise the standard, shoot for excellence. A man ain't just going to be a man. I don't want to hear that. That's why you got these boys grabbing on girls now and walking with their boxers showing. I told y'all last week, I didn't mean no harm, as you need to be able to speak basic English. If his pants slip down just one time, I don't care if it's an accident or anything, that's done. You ain't going. Somebody say, they're going to sneak out anyway. I'm going to follow them. They're going to be at the theater. I'm going to be in the top row with my pellet. No, I meant, but I'm going to be at the top row, and I'm going to be, oh, I got to go. Is there anybody who needs to come? Is there anybody needs to come? It ain't no boys, just be boys. Girls gonna be girls. We all have made our mistakes. Own up to it. Don't be ashamed of it. Use it as a testimony. Flip it into some kind of ministry. Do I have somebody who wants to change this morning? But you're gonna have to say, but I, every person in the New Testament, whether it be the man possessed, whether it be a man born blind from birth, whether it be the water at the not just people, but inanimate objects. Whether it be the water at the wedding of Cana, it had to turn into wine because Jesus commanded it to. Whether it be five loaves and two fish that are multiplied because Jesus commanded them to be multiplied. Whatever he comes in contact with, he came in contact with death. And death had to step down. And death had to be in subjection to him. And he did it for us. Anytime, how old are you now? 40-something, 50-something, 30-something? Any by the time you try a different alternative to your life? You know, people are dying every day in their 20s. And in their 30s and in their 40s, you take for granted that you're going to have health. Take for granted that everybody in your family is always going to be nice and neat and safe. Take for granted that you got time to get it right. That is the biggest lie ever told. Time does not heal your issues. Faith in Christ will heal anybody. And the moment I stop believing that, I need to sit down from preaching. Somebody says, I haven't experienced it for myself because you have not experienced Christ. Any man being Christ, Paul says he's a new creation. Old things have passed away. And all things are coming new. It's a good feeling to look up one morning and look in the mirror and say, I'm not the same man. That is a great feeling to say, I am better on this day than I was 1 year ago today. That's a good feeling to say, I'm better today than I was yesterday. I'm going to stumble along the way. I'm going to struggle. but I'm dependent upon him for everything I need. Is there a young lady, somebody who needs to come? And, you know, and I'm going to call this morning. Maybe if there's a young lady to come, maybe we need to have some change sisters who've already said they experienced that change to come and stand with somebody. Whispering in your girlfriend, I know what you're going through. I've been there, done that, and look what the Lord did on me. I went from a Sunday service skipper to a Sunday school teacher. Paul went from a persecutor to a church to a champion for the cause of Christ. Peter and Andrew went from fishermen on the side of the sea to fishermen of men. Rahab, the harlot, was saved. When she received the spies and peace, she didn't perish with the unbelieving, but she had enough faith to believe what God was doing. Mentioned in the Hall of Faith. You can't tell me God can't change you. You can't tell me Jesus Christ ain't real. He's in my heart. He's in my soul. He's in my mind. He's in my being this morning. I want you to listen to the song. And you may not do it. I like to close my eyes. Can y'all just play this? And then we'll ask you to come forward. But just listen to this song for a second. Close your eyes if you can. Turn off the tablets, the phones. Just for a second. Turn it up just a little bit. If you close your eyes, think about our condition this morning. Can y'all get it on this main speaker? We have technical difficulties. I want you to listen to this song. I've been listening to it all week, and I've been thinking about the words of it. And I know we sing it all the time, but powerful. I wonder what the condition of was the individual when they were writing it. If we can get it on the main speaker up there, just as I am. No, I'll keep talking. I want y'all to... Just as I am. If you need to come on down, you can come. You don't have to wait.
Shut up.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful. That's beautiful. Anybody need to come this morning? Look at the words of the song, "Just as I am." He says, you can see beyond my pretenses, beyond what I say, what I do before you. My heart's an open book, uncovered. But the beautiful thing is the Lord accepts us. When you come into the family of God, you're now part of the accepted. And somebody says, I'm not accepted anyway, but the Lord accepts you just the way you are. Is there anybody this morning that needs to come? Come on this morning. Since I want to change, we're going to pray. Someone says, I want to change. I'm ready to change, and I'm going to walk out of here, and I will not ready to change. I will be changed. I'm done. I'm changed. Someone says, that easy? I'm going to pray this morning, if the brothers don't mind. I'm going to pray this morning for all of those sisters, maybe brothers who need to come, and says, I'm ready to change today. It's going to take an act of God and an act of faith. But if you really want to change today, get up from your seat and come just as you are. Satan's going to tell you, no, you need to go home and pull some things together and get you a game plan. Uh-uh. Just as you are right now, in this moment, in your weakness, in your struggle, right where you are. Right where you are. So you'll know how I was before I decided to change. I decided to change on December the 18th, 2016, and I never looked back. I decided to stop suffering. I decided to stop being desperate. I decided to stop being thirsty. I decided to stop being in pain. I decided to stop grieving over things I can't control. I decided to stop whoever this stuff. I decided to stop rehashing everything bad that has ever happened in my life. And I gave it to Christ. Now I'm going to turn around and tell another woman about what Christ has done to me. Young lady, you don't have to be like this. You don't have to cry every night. You don't have to wander around looking for answers. Christ is your all in all. You are complete in Christ. You don't need nothing and nobody else. I know I got to sit down because we live in the age of drive-through church. But every once in a while, somebody said, that's every Sunday. I know, but forgive me and pray for me. But I just believe that somebody here this morning is been looking for something, and your answer is in the Word of God. It's right here in the Word of God. You got to get it from the woman at the issue. You got to get it from the woman in John 8. You got to get it from Jairus' daughter. You got to get it from Mary and Martha and the woman with the alabaster box. That's all you need is the Word of God. And you need a great support system, which you should find in a loving congregation. We have some that have come. Do anybody else need to come? I think we're just going to sing Jesus this morning. I was trying to think of another song, but ain't no other song that describes it. How I love calling your name. My favorite verse in that song is, there's times in my life when I felt so all alone, but when I needed you, Jesus, you said all I had to do was call. Sometimes I called you in the morning. Sometimes I called you over the night. But when I got up off my knees, I carried all of my stuff with me. I kept rehashing what happened to me. I was still in pain 5-10 years later. No, everything was all right because I called upon you. You heard my cry. You inclined your ear and you blessed me. You took my feet out of the miry clay and set my feet, took me out of the horrible pit and set me on solid ground. You reoriented me. Just like the Samaritan woman, I was confused about a lot of things, but you set me straight. Now I know what it means to worship God. And now I got to tell somebody what God has done for me. We got time for you. Cowboys got flexed. They come on at 7:30 today. And even if the Cowboys came on at 11:30, Jerry ain't giving me a single one of his billions. No endorsements. But we are not in the business of scoring touchdowns anymore. We are in the business of saving souls and changing lives. That's on the table here this morning. Some have been touched by the Word of God. Others need to come. Maybe your pride is in the way. Tell your pride to go. Nobody cares about how cute you look. And it's nothing impressive. This is the type of, nobody cares about how righteous you've been and how good you are. Because I know the truth. It's only the grace of God that makes us who we are. grace of God. Ooh, with the grace of God, Brother Gilmore, you can stand tall and hold your head up. With the grace of God, you can feel good about where you are today. Grace of God, you can love your wife and your children. Grace of God, you can serve with fervor and vigor. With the grace of God, you don't grow tired in well-doing. Holy Spirit is pricking somebody this morning. Are you going to go back home and get under the cover? You going to be depressed the rest of the week? That's your choice. I'm not dreaming of a white Christmas. I'm dreaming of a whole Christmas where I'm complete in Christ. We're going to sing Jesus, Let's Stand. Just as you are, come on. Just as you, right now, just what you, whatever state you're in, come on. If you come from the bridge, come on. Whether you come from across town, come on. If you've been to church a long time, that don't matter. Don't matter if you think somebody's going to think something, that don't matter. We are going to pray. And if you may not want to fill out a card, some, we're going to answer those responses that fill out a card. But if you just want to come and stand with somebody, young ladies, if you need to come, maybe you made some poor choices. And just say, I just need to do better. I just need to do better. We're going to sing Jesus. And you're going to have time to think about it. And you can come. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, oh, sweet Jesus. Oh, how I love. I just love to call. Oh, I love you, Jesus. Nobody but Jesus, yeah. Oh, every day, Lord, I know your name is. Oh, there was trouble all around me, Lord. Lord, I didn't have to despair. 'Cause, Lord, you told me you would always be there. And it seems that, Lord, it seems all my problems, oh, they had all had just begun. Whoa, I don't worry no more. They were already won. And I love you, Jesus. Nobody but Jesus, yeah. Oh, I love, yeah, to call. Oh, and I love you, Jesus. Nobody but Jesus, yeah. Oh, every day, Lord. I can hear the woman in Samaria singing this. Your name is. Oh, there have been times in my life, Lord, when I felt so all alone. When I needed you, Jesus, you said all I had to do was call. And sometimes I called you in the morning, and sometimes I called you over in the night. When I got up off of my knees, every little thing was alright. They called him Jesus. Nobody but Jesus, yeah. Oh, I love, yeah, to call. When I'm down and out, I say Jesus. When I'm burning low, I say, Jesus, yeah. You may be seated. Oh, every day, Lord, still time. And I know your name is. Oh, now have you ever lost somebody that was oh so close to you? Oh, it hurt your heart so bad till you didn't know what to do. And somehow you called upon the Lord. Tears were streaming from your eyes. This morning I stopped to say that I know somebody who has made it all right. They called him Jesus. Jesus. Nobody but Jesus, yeah. Oh, I love to call. Ain't nobody do me like Jesus. Can't nobody love me like Jesus. Whoa, every day, Lord, I know your name is. Oh, keep calling on him, Jesus. Nobody but Jesus, yeah. Oh, I love to call. Oh, we love you, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, every day, Lord, I know your name is a change. Jesus is the only one for me. When I think of him, my mind is refreshed. And all the troubles of this world won't get me down. In him I find sweet him, my mind is refreshed, and all the troubles of this world won't get me down. In him I find sweet peace of.
Let the church say amen. I want to thank Brother Bailey again for that fine message. Like I always told him, keep it real. So we have quite a number who have came down this morning, and I'm not going to try to call everybody names, so I'm just going to get a mic and let them say what's on their heart. All right? But we got Sister Garfield.
Sam, I want to thank you for that message. A lot of you all have no idea of my story. And I want to thank you, Sam, for giving me the strength today. I'm not going to tell my story. But what I am going to say is I'm glad God brought me through. Like he said, you do a lot of stuff in shame. Well, my shame called me mama every day. And I'm thankful for that. I want to thank God.